Welcome to Emmanuel Ministry. Anybody glad to be here this morning? Amen. Amen. Well, let's start it off right with prayer this morning. Brother Travis, would you lead us? Amen. Well, we're glad you're here, and if this is your first time here at Emmanuel Ministry, we want you to raise your hand real quickly, and that will allow Roy to bring you a visitor's card to fill out. We want you to fill that out, and at the time when we take up our offering, just put that in the offering plate. You'll recognize that moment when it comes. That way we can get your name and contact information so we can stay in touch with you. We've got several announcements this morning. The dates of Vacation Bible School have been changed to Saturday, August the 1st, through Wednesday, August the 5th. That's from 6 to 8:30 p.m. If you were not at the meeting last Sunday, a clipboard is in the foyer to put your information on if you want to help. Another clipboard is there for your Vacation Bible School T-shirt order. All sizes will be $12 each. Money is due when the order is placed. Make checks payable to the church. Also, there is another announcement this morning. If anybody that's in the same family unit, you can occupy two joining pews this morning. Am I understanding that correctly? So, yeah. So, everybody hear that? So you don't have to skip a pew if you've got the same family unit there. You can have adjoining pews there. All right. So the work is still going to be done as planned on the pavilion. The starting date will be announced later. See Les Harlow for more information. The food bank still needs your clean plastic grocery bags. There has been more fresh produce in the past few months, which calls for more bags. An abundance of food. That's a good problem to have, isn't it? Okay. June activity calendars and new daily devotionals can be picked up in the foyers. Make sure you grab one of those today if you don't already have one. Also, prayer and praise gathering tonight at Wisdom Faith Church. That'll be at 6 p.m. You are invited. And that concludes our announcements.
Amen. Good morning. We invite you to worship the Lord with us today. The song says, "Forever." Give thanks to the Lord our God and King. His love endures forever. Right? Not just a short period of time. But his love endures forever, for he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. So, Lord, we just worship you today. We just thank you for who you are, for you are good, Lord. You are above all things, and we're just so thankful that your love doesn't endure just for a short period of time, Lord, but it's forever. We're so thankful for who you are. For your kingdom. We pray your kingdom come and your will be done in our service here today, Lord. Holy Spirit, we just invite you in to take control of this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Mighty hand and outstretched arms, his love endures.
His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever.
Forever, God is with us. Isn't that awesome? What's His word says? He will never leave you nor forsake you. He will never leave you. Didn't say when times get tough or things get hard, He's going to walk out. He says He would never leave you nor forsake you. This next song says, the King of my heart, let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run. The Bible says, if you abide in the shadow of the Almighty, amen, talks about abiding. He is our refuge, our stronghold, in whom we trust. Be the mountain where I run. That's a refuge, amen. That's a refuge. That's a place of peace, of protection. It says, if you say the Lord is your refuge, no evil shall befall you. Amen. Who's going to keep you from evil? Amen. Jesus prayed. He said, I pray, Father, that you don't take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. Amen. The model prayer that Jesus gave us to pray at the very end of it, he said, Jesus taught us to pray this and deliver us from evil. Amen. He's the mountain where we run. Amen. The King of my heart. You know, Pastor said a long time ago, he said, is Jesus your Savior? Is He just your Savior, or is He your Lord? A lot of us call Him Savior, right? But is He our Lord? The disciples referred to Him as Master. The disciples referred to Him as Master, right? So if you've got somebody, if He's the King, we want to do what the King says to do, right? We want to be obedient to the King. If He's got some instruction for us. It says, King of my heart. You know, sometimes on planet Earth we get hurt. Maybe you've been wounded. It happens. Maybe you've been wounded and you don't want to share your heart. You know, after you've been hurt, you're kind of controlling. You don't step out. You're afraid to share yourself, right, when you've been hurt by individuals. But how many know we can trust the Lord with our heart? Amen. We can trust Him. Again, He will never leave you nor forsake you. Amen.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run. The fountain let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide. The ransom for my life, holy is my song. Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run. The fountain I drink from, holy. Shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, it's
thankful.
You're never gonna make, you're never gonna make me die.
We're thankful, Lord.
You're never gonna make, you're never gonna make me die. You're never gonna make,
Lord, you are good. You are good. Lord, we're thankful that we can trust you with our heart, Lord. We're thankful that we can trust you, Lord. You are good. You are enough, Lord.
You know, so much in life, whenever a storm faces you, whenever you face the hardest thing maybe you've ever faced your whole life, you just have to look in the face of your storm and thank your God that He is with you. You have to get on your face before Him and thank Him for what He has done. That Jesus is enough. The name of Jesus breaks every single barrier, every single chain, every single addiction, every single sickness, every single cancer, every single disease that could ever plague you. There is nothing that the name of Jesus won't do for you. All you have to do is come. All you have to do is receive. All you have to do is believe on the name of Jesus today, and He will save you from whatever you're facing. It may not be instantaneous, but it is in the movement of whatever He is doing. It will come to pass. His word is what it is. There is nothing less and nothing more. Take it at face value. Jesus, we believe that you are enough. Just raise your hands today and let's just agree that Jesus is enough today. We believe that you are enough, Jesus. We believe that you are enough.
I am not what I make. I am who you have made me to be. I am not what I have done. I am loved unconditionally. And I am not loved by the measure of love that I bring. I am not who I know. I am known by the King of all kings.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus, you are enough for me.
The only name under heaven by which men might be saved. His blood alone was shed for the remission of our sins. Amen. His blood is the blood of the new covenant. Our covenant relationship with the Father is through him. Amen. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. Amen. So Jesus, you are enough.
I see heaven invading this place, and I see angels, they're praising your holy name, and I sing praises, I give you honor, worthy Jesus. The healing of all disease. And I sing praises, I sing praises. I give you honor.
Father, you are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God.
We give you praise,
all of the honor.
You are our God, the one we live for.
We give you praise, all of the glory.
All of the honor, you are our God, the one we live for.
We give you praise, all of the glory,
I don't know about you, but I'm glad to be in Hart County, Kentucky. I'm glad to be in Lee Grand today, worshiping the Lord and praising the Lord right here in this wonderful state. Praise God. Isn't God good? Amen. He could have planted you, I guess, anywhere in the world, but he got you right here in this area. And I tell you, you're just blessed for that. You better know that. You could be in Southeast Pakistan, but here you are. Loving the Lord and praising the Lord and being loved by God. Amen. Our deacons are coming to pick up the plates and to pass them around and gather up everything you got. So let's have it. No, I was just kidding. We want you to go ahead and be blessed today with your giving of your tithes and offerings, because that is a blessing. When we come in line with what God has told us to do, seed time and harvest, and we begin to give and honor God with our tithes and offerings, I tell you, it's just amazing how God looses things for you when you come into faith in that area. I can remember, Linda and I can remember, when we came to faith in that area, what a difference it made in our lives. For a while, it looked like nothing was going to work, and then after a while, it looked like everything worked. So we're just praising the Lord, for he is a good God, and he is faithful today. Amen. Let's sing this song here, "One Day, More Than I Could Hope or Dream Of." Amen. That's what God's doing in our lives today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We need your help now. Get in here to help us sing this. Yeah, that'll be good. Use them hands. That's why we got off the wall thing. Amen. More than I could hope or dream of, you have put your favor on me. One day in the house of God is better than a thousand days in the world. Yeah. One day in the house of God is better than a thousand days in the world. Me. Let's all sing it together. Lord, you're more than enough for me. Amen. Lord, you're more than enough for me. Ain't that the truth this morning? Lord, you're more than enough for me. Blessed, I can't contain it. So much I gotta give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I gotta give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. Amen. Well, this new way of doing everything's got me all messed up, and I sent that offering out without blessing it. But y'all blessed it before you gave it. You're blessed again, won't you, Betty Jean? All right, it is blessed. So it's different to what we're doing in here, but praise the Lord. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be in the house of the Lord. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord, to plant seed, not only to give of our tithes and the offering, but to plant a seed. You said plant a seed and meet a need. So, Lord, we thank you that there are needs in our community. There are needs around. So we plant those seeds in effect to cause an effect and a cure, to call deliverance and wholeness and well-being to come to the families that's in perils in our area. We thank you, Lord, that you blessed us, you sustained us, you've given us more than enough because you are the El Shaddai God, the God who is more than enough. Therefore, we don't have to be tight or tight-fisted. We can be liberal with our giving because you give it as we give it. You press it down, shake it together, and give it back to us through gifts and talents and abilities and dreams and visions and all kinds of ways that you lead us and guide us and direct us in our affairs of life. We thank you, Lord, that you're for us, and we don't care who's against us because you're on our side. So we know we'll not be denied. Every promise of God's yes and amen. And we just give you praise for it right now in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's praise him one more time. Father, we praise you. Thank you, Lord, that you're for us and not against us. Am I on or off? On? All right. I don't want to be off. I want to be on. Here you go, brother. Hallelujah. Y'all had a good week?
Yes.
This is a beautiful week. Going to be a better week even next week. Praise the Lord. This is I don't know how you could write it any better than yesterday. It was just about as outstanding as you could get it. Amen. And made no difference where I was at and what I was doing yesterday. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Amen. And I'm glad that that's the way it is. And I believe God wants it to be as heaven on earth. Amen. He said to pray that away. You notice when Jesus' disciples who followed Jesus and knew him better than anybody, when they asked him for something, they didn't ask him, Lord, teach us how to preach. Lord, teach us how to prophesy. Lord, teach us how to hand out food. Teach us how to pray. Now, reckon why they asked that. Don't you reckon they realized that when Jesus come out of them prayer sessions that he had something going on? When Jesus spent time with the Lord Jesus, with Father God, he come out of there and things happened. I believe they noticed that to the point that they said, we want to know how to do that. Don't you want to know how to do that? I believe God wants us to know how to do those things. Because he said himself, these things and greater will you do because I'm going to the Father. What's so big about that? Well, when he went to the Father, he loosed the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit was loosed to come back to help us and empower us, just like Jesus. You see, what made Jesus so powerful was the anointing of God. It wasn't in himself. He said that himself. He said, when you see me, you see the Father. It's the Father that does the works. Amen. So what gave him great power and great ability was the anointing. Matter of fact, it says how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and power who went about doing good. Amen. Don't you think he's got an anointing today? You're mighty quiet. Don't you think he's got an anointing today? Amen. Don't you think he could anoint his body today? Yes. We are the body. Yes. Amen. Amen. Jesus was the earthly body of God. God came down to the earth in Jesus. When you've seen Jesus, you've seen the visible God. God. Jesus Christ made God visible. You could see him. You could comprehend him through that person. The name of Jesus carries the power of God. Now we are the body of Christ. Amen. Jesus was the body then, but he said, I can do nothing except the Father anoint me. It was all under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And Peter even said how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and power. And because of that anointing, he went around doing good and healing and taking care of business. Well, as God was in his body then, in Jesus, don't you think he's in his body now? Are you the body of Christ? Are we the body of Christ? Are you the body of Christ? Amen. Well, the same anointing will achieve in the body today what it achieved then. Amen. God wants us to be that way. He wants every location, every area in the country to have a body assembled together that represents and represents the Lord Jesus Christ in that area, in that region, in that place. Amen. And it don't have to be just one per county. It can be 20. I don't care. But we got to come into the stature of the fullness of Christ that we might represent Christ to the community. Now, if I was a devil, and I'm not, I'd try to cause division and strife and envy and all kind of problems in the body. Because when the body's got that problem, it cannot operate at full strength. Amen. When there's envy and strife and division and all kinds of things, I mean, if you got that going on in your body, you can't operate either at full speed, right? So the same way with the church. So the devil wants to keep something stirred up all the time. He tries and tries because he knows he really has no power over the body of Christ. But if he can get them limb against limb and faction against faction and division, we need to go this way. The preacher wants to go that way. Well, y'all pray that he change and go my way. No. Better pray that we all go God's way. Amen. Amen. So when you got division, what you got? You don't have harmony and unity. You can't succeed in what God wants for you. So praise God. Aren't you glad we have no envy, division, strife, or nothing like that going on around here? Amen. We want each and every one to be anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. I want you to be anointed. You're a tissue. You're a limb. You're a joint. You're something of the body of Christ. And whatever it is that God has you providing in this era, in this body today, I believe you could be a different joint tomorrow. I believe you could be a different limb the next day. Who knows? But when we all are under the unction of the Holy Ghost, abiding in Jesus and Jesus abiding in us, I believe we can put forth the full throttle ability of God and through Jesus Christ in his body in this area. I believe we can do the same thing that Jesus accomplished in this area. Don't you? Amen. Isn't that something for us to look for? Isn't that something for us to search for, seek after, that the Lord God, I believe there's an explosive power that's available to the church today. This is Pentecost Sunday. This is 40 days after. Amen. Today's recognized as Pentecost Sunday. That's the day really the church got to unction to go forth with the function. Amen. Amen. Now, some of the church had been breathed on by the Holy Ghost. John chapter 20:20, the Holy Ghost had breathed on the disciples there when Jesus was gathered with them. He breathed on them and said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. But then later on, he told them there in the book of Acts chapter 1, he said, I want you to not leave Jerusalem until the fullness of that day comes. There's something going to happen. There's a power that's fixing to fall. Amen. The baptism of the Holy Ghost is going to come. As you've been baptized in water, the Father, we're going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost and power. Amen. He told them, directed them, don't even go out and try to start anything until you get that. That's Trent's translation. Why did he say that? Because he knew they was limited if they went without the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And guess what? We are too. If you don't catch that, you won't seek after him. If you don't know that, you won't search for him and seek him with all of your heart. And the Bible says if we search for him and seek him, seek after him with all of our heart, we'll get it. Amen. Now, they had to wait. The reason they had to wait in Jerusalem, because that time hadn't been fulfilled and the day of Pentecost fully come. But the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 2 that day was fully come. Let's go to Acts chapter 2, if you will. Off my sermon, or what my notes are, but that's all right. Notes are notes, and they'll keep. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 2. Now, this is what Jesus said, that I'm going away, and after I go away, I'll send the Comforter to you. That's what Jesus told them. Amen. Now, we know that as we've read the Bible, look back. Can you get in their shoes, having not ever read the Bible, Acts chapter 2? They didn't have Acts chapter 2 for their pleasure at that time. They was going to be in Acts chapter 2. So I'm sure that they didn't absolutely know it for sure what's going to happen here. Now I believe when they, and I believe I could prove it if I wanted to get into scripture in Corinthians, that there was some 500 people gathered at one time with Christ as he was ministering. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there was 120. Now reckon what happened. I figure about 380 of them said, why sit we here? Let's go do something. But when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there was 120 in the upper room. Amen. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were in one accord, in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. And you know, filling the house is one thing, but filling me and filling you, something else, ain't it? I don't just want the house full. I want the body of Christ full of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Now, praise God, he can get wall to wall. Ain't no doubt about that. There's enough of God to fill a house, no doubt. It's enough to make the house shake. It's enough to make it look like it's on fire. They experienced all kinds of things in the day of Pentecost back in that time. And, you know, I have no doubt the signs and wonders and miraculous things will be performed again. And no doubt people would try to get rid of us. They're already trying to get rid of us, and we ain't all that big a threat yet. Not as big a threat as we need to be. Amen. But when we get to that point, don't you think they want to put us out? That's exactly what they want to do, put them out. But bring it on, Lord. Amen. Praise God. And suddenly there fell from heaven a sound like a rushing mighty wind that filled all the house. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues of fire as it set upon them. And they were all filled. Notice this. All filled. 120 of them. Not just the 12 disciples. All filled. Tell me what all means. Does that mean all? That means every one of them, doesn't it? Well, that means to me today, God don't want just the preacher's filled. Just a prophet's field, just a teacher's field, just an evangelist's field. He wants the whole church filled. He wants everybody filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, why would he want that? Because God knows the limitations you have within yourself. You can only achieve so much without him. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing, but with me, we can do all things. So God knows that. And the reason he knows that is because he's seen that in his own body. He's seen that in his own self. Jesus in his own self, he want one place there, and he could do there no mighty works. Only those that came to him with some faith could he do anything about. You see, with the anointing, we can only achieve those things. As we teach people and bring people to the knowledge of the truth, and they begin to ask, seek, and knock, then God can use us to bring about that. But when the anointing comes, I'm telling you, when the anointing comes, it breaks yokes. It sets people free. I mean, people just coming in the house and get loosed. Amen. I remember the old building many years ago, we was under the unction of the Holy Ghost, and about the service had just got started good. We'd had a good praise service. I just got up and kind of cleared my throat to preach, and the side door opened, and in come this young lady. And when she come through the door, I seen this big hand up over her, pointed down like that. What's them styrofoam things that they have at the ball games with that big finger number one? It was one of them like upside down pointed at her. She come through the door, looked my way, looked the other way, and she went up this area. That little hand was right on top of her. She come across back behind that set of pews, back behind this set of pews, come down over here, and before she got in her seat, she done under conviction. She came to the altar and got saved right there. Amen. That's the unction. That's the anointing. That's the power of God. She wasn't in there long enough to hear me preach good about Jesus. She probably done heard about him. But the Holy Ghost had got on her probably before she left the house. Amen. Praise God. I believe that can happen to us. Amen. Preaching shouldn't be hard. We shouldn't try to convince everybody and just wring their arms until they say uncle to get them into the church. Amen. There ought to be a power and anointing and ability of the Holy Ghost that brings conviction, that brings something in the heart, and a contrite spirit comes upon people, and they begin to weep under the unction of the Holy Ghost. I've seen that before many times. I've seen people weep. That's all they done. Weeped a little. Once they got the pressure off with a weep, they never come forth and done anything. But praise God, many times after they do, they weep a little, but then they go on and get saved. And I'm thankful for that, aren't you? I believe God wants to put a little more ump in our pump. Amen. I believe we need to sit before the Holy Ghost. I believe we need to spend time in the presence of God. If any one thing ever described the world today is busy. But you know, for about 60 days, there's people that's always been busy that wasn't busy, that had time to pray through, so to speak, had time to spend some time with God. But I don't know what they've done, but I still hadn't seen that big shaking revival take place yet. Amen. We still need to set time apart to be with God. That's how Jesus received the anointing and the ability of God, is because he spent time with God, not just telling him how bad it was, not just telling him, I don't know what we're going to do if you're going to show up. I don't believe he prayed a prayer like that. I believe he spent time with the Father just listening to him. Say, here I am, God, but I know I can't do nothing without an unction. I know I can't do nothing unless you send me ability, power. I need something. And I believe God downloaded inside of him visions and dreams and all kinds of things. And he just went out and walked out what he's seen from God. Amen. I believe that's still available for the body of Christ today. Yes, for the preacher. Yes, for the teacher. Yes, for the evangelist. Yes, for the prophet. But for the entire body. God wants the entire body filled with the Holy Ghost. Filled with the Holy Ghost. And I'll go on at it. And for you at home, just hang on to your hat. I believe we want you filled with the Holy Ghost as the evidence of speaking in other tongues. I want you to be bubbling over with the Spirit of God, that you can pray prayers like you ain't never prayed before, that you have an unction like you ain't never had an unction before. Now, that's one thing we don't see that took place in Jesus' life. Why? Because Pentecost hadn't come. Simple. You say, well, if it's all important, why didn't Jesus pray in the Holy Ghost? Because that wasn't in the area that where he was at the time. If he's here today, you believe he would. Amen. Amen. But see, that's a dispensation that we're in today. The dispensation of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Pentecost. We should be Pentecostal churches. Amen. The Pentecostal Church of Christ. The Pentecostal Church of Christ of Latter-day Saints. The Pentecostal Church of God of Christ in Lee Grand. I don't know what you call it, but just get full of the Holy Ghost and wind up and go do something. Amen. Let's just let her loose, baby. Amen. We just need to get full of God. We can't stand it. Like fire shut up in our bones. Amen. I've looked forward to preaching today. I love to talk about Pentecost because I know what a change it made in my life. Mundane, just a mundane Christian. Pretty carnal I was, to be honest with you. Exceedingly carnal many times. But, oh, it changed my life when the Holy Ghost settled in on me. And I got filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other tongues and pray in other tongues, sit before God and hear God, sit at his table and have him to talk to me about things. What a change it made in my life. And it'll make a change in your life, too. I know it will. I'm absolutely convinced of that. If we just take, show that God, that we know that you have the answer and accept you help us, we'll not make it. The Bible says, except the Lord build a house, they labor in vain that build it. You can work hard 60, 70 years and it all be burned up. Is it hay, wood, or stubble? Or is it gold? Huh? Is it precious metal? Is it stone? Is it gems or whatever that? I can't remember exactly what that is, but there's six areas there. Hay, wood, and stubble is what's going to be burnt up. That's all that we've achieved within ourselves. We can do it. We just like the song from New York, I did it my way. Well, your way will go up smoke if you ain't careful, Doc. Amen. Then what's going to happen? I want to do it. I don't want to do it my way. I want to do it His way. Amen. Because His way will stand the test of time. Praise God. Now, I've got good news for you. And some of you don't believe it. It may be bad news for you, but I believe it's good news. If you're truly born again of the Spirit of Almighty God, unless you curse God and die, I believe you'll get to go to heaven. Amen. That's what I believe. Because your works is not what saved you. Huh? But I'll tell you this. If you don't do something with Jesus, you won't have no reward. Everything you do will be burned up. And you'll be tried as by fire, but you'll make it through. I believe that. Amen. Now, do I believe that every person saved automatically guaranteed go to heaven? No, but I believe you can curse God and die. I really do believe that. Now, I don't recommend you do that. I'll tell you that. That's about stupid on top of stupid right there. Amen. But you know that you know that you know you've been born again. You stay true to that. Don't you let go of that. Don't you be ashamed of that. Don't you deny Christ. Huh? I don't care where you're at and what you're doing. Don't deny the Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe you'll make it. Aren't you thankful for that? But I'll tell you what, there's something better than that. You can not only make it, but you can take your children with you. Huh? I don't want you to be like Lot. Huh? I don't want you to be like Lot that pitched his tent towards Sodom. He saw the glittering and plains of Sodom. He saw all that, and he pitched his tent that away. And guess what happened? He lost everything but two daughters. Even his wife turned to a pillar of salt. All the rest of them servants and hard hands, all the rest of that, went up in smoke. He's a type of what can happen to you and me if we let flesh lead us and guide us and direct us. God wants you loose. He wants you loose from traditions and habits of man and commandments of man. But He don't want you so loose that you got no control. He wants some control in your life. Iniquity is without God's rule. Amen. So we don't want to go from one ditch to the other ditch. We want to get up here in the middle of this thing and work with God. Amen. The Holy Ghost will help you do that. You'll be a better Christian. You'll be a better husband. You'll be a better wife. You'll be a better son or daughter. You'll be a better employer with the Holy Ghost in your life. I can't preach it no plainer than that. Hallelujah. So Jesus came and fulfilled His mission. What was His mission? He tells us in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, I believe it is, the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which is lost. Amen. Jesus came to do that, and He got her done. Amen. The Bible says, He that knew no sin was made sin for us who were sinners. The Bible says that the just for the unjust, that He might bring us to God. Amen. The Bible says that we were all separated. Sin had separated us. Iniquity had separated us from God. We'd all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But all sin was laid upon the Lord Jesus Christ, that whosoever comes to Him, believes in Him, and relies upon Him and rests in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now, you can have that by trusting Jesus and staying true to Jesus. I mean, that's a gift from God. The eternal life, salvation, is a gift from God. You don't have to jump up and down or roll up and down the aisles or nothing for it. That's a gift from God. But God wants you to not only have the gift of eternal life, the gift of salvation, but He wants you to be baptized in the Holy Ghost so you can do something for Him. So you can be a vessel, a living vessel for His glory and His honor. Amen. Now, anybody that's been born again knows that you got flesh to contend with. And if you don't bring your flesh under, you'll just obey the flesh. The five senses of man are an enemy to the spirit realm. What you feel, what you see, what you touch, what you taste, all that are enemies to us. That's what got us in trouble to start with. They ate of that forbidden tree. What was that forbidden tree? Well, that forbidden tree brought about the five senses. And when that five senses came, they saw they was naked. Huh? They was as naked as a jaybird before then. They didn't recognize it. Now, they got the five senses working. Amen? Amen. It was an enemy. It brought a curse. Amen. So what's the answer? What's going to get us out of that dilemma? Amen. Now, I'm not saying we're going to go back and be filled with the Holy Ghost and be a bunch of nudists. No. Heavens, no. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Nobody. Keep your clothes on, Hoss. Amen. But God wants to bring us back to the place we're not moved by our sense realm. We're moved by the Spirit of the living God. And that's exactly how Jesus became so successful. And that's exactly why Jesus bore our sins. The hand of God was upon him and brought him to that place where he became the sacrifice for our sins. He was not born of Adam's race. He was born of God. God put the blood in Jesus' DNA. So that way he was a perfect sacrifice, born not conceived in sin, but he was born of the Spirit of God from the very beginning, and he lived a full life without sinning and became the sacrifice for man's sin. Now that was Jesus' leg of the race. Isn't that right? And then he told us in John's Gospel. Let's turn over to John's Gospel. I know I didn't get through with Acts. I'm just like that. Let's go over to John's Gospel and John chapter 14 and verse 15. How many here love the Lord this morning? What about the rest of you? Y'all love the Lord too? All right. Praise God. I'm glad everybody here loves Jesus. Now, I'll tell you what you can prove your love for Jesus. It's provable. Jesus said it was. He said, you'll know my disciples by the love, the fruit of love. You can tell how much a person really loves God by just watching their walk. Amen. Now, you know what? I don't mean nothing bad by that. But here's what Jesus said in verse 15 of John 14. If you love me, do what? Keep my commands. Oh, we don't like that word commands today. We don't like them word commands. And when somebody begins to command us to do something, we kind of rile up a little bit. Huh? Amen. Even if it's for our good, we still don't like it. And I understand. Because sometimes people try to take dominion over us and just rule us in the wrong way. But God, when he takes dominion over us and rules us, it's the right way. And we got to trust God to the point that we take his commandments serious. And when God gives us a command, we need to stand up to it and listen to it and obey it. Amen? Now, don't go quiet on me. Amen? If we love the Lord, he said, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter. That's what Jesus is talking about. I've come to fulfill this leg of the race. I have brought you to a place to where you are loose from your sins and your iniquities. You were separated from God, but I have brought you back to God. The just for the unjust, to what? Bring us back to God. So we now qualified through the blood of Jesus, through the washing of the water of the Spirit of God and the Word of God, we're qualified to be anointed of the Holy Ghost. Jesus Christ was anointed, and that priesthood changed there when John the Baptist, who was, like him or not, he might not have dressed real good, but he was a man of God sent for the particular anointing upon him. He rested, and I don't understand all those things about the priesthood, but all of it come together right there. And when John baptized Jesus, his reign was over. John said, I got to decrease that he might increase. Basically, this is the reason I came, a forerunner of Christ, to bring him to fulfill the scripture and baptize him, and he entered into a new area, a new testament, a new way of living. A new thing happened right there when Jesus come up out of the water. When he come up out of the water, the Bible said the Spirit descended upon him like a dove, bodily like a dove. And here's the thing about it, different from what happened in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, the anointing would come. The Old Testament, the anointing would settle upon the prophet, priest, and king, but it never remained there. You notice that? They would just be anointed for a specific event, for a specific time. But when it came upon Jesus, here it is. It stayed. The anointing come upon him, and it didn't lift. It remained. Amen. So that set a new era, that set a new principle, that brought things into the now where we're at today, so that same anointing can come upon us and remain. Amen. Amen. You don't have to come to church to get the anointing on Sundays. You can get it at the Pentecost and it'll stay with you. Amen. If you just build yourself up in the most holy faith, praising God, staying true to God, listening to God, and that anointing will rest upon you just like it rested upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And God will give you specific commands. We all have general commands from God in the Bible. But God will give you specific commands. That's why some are called in certain areas to do certain things. And you have to know. You have to know. Because if you don't know, some preacher will come along and preach you out of it. Huh? Somebody will talk you out of it. But if you know, praise God. I know one thing. The Lord called me to do a work here. And you know, I knew this. I knew I couldn't do it by myself. I knew we couldn't do it by ourselves. I knew we was going to need some help. So I went down to the banker, and he tried his best to talk us out of it. He sure did. He said, we can't help you. And I talked to one banker, and I know for sure, if I called his name today, he knew what I was talking about was going to be blessed. But he was so under such restrictions from the banking organization he's in, he couldn't help us. But praise God, you got to stay at it. See, you got to know. I know. I know God put this in my heart. I was minding my own business when he did it. I wasn't asking God to do this. I wasn't praying asking God to do this thing here. I was minding my own business, and the Holy Ghost came upon me. And I wrote that thing down in a piece of paper on my wall in the office now. Build, build, build. People, people, buildings. Take this region from me. They'll come from the north, east, south, and west. Le grand shall be in the deed le big. Amen. Praise God. Our best is yet to come. Amen. But it ain't going to come without the Holy Ghost. It ain't going to come unless this body gets empowered by the Holy Ghost and we go about doing good like Jesus did. And I'm talking about not just one spot. I'm talking about 120 or 30 spots. All of us get filled with the Holy Ghost, go out there in our world. I mean, it could be 120 little Jesuses this week all over the country. Amen. From Greene County to Warren County to LaRue County, all over the country. Amen. Why? Because that same power, that same anointing that was resting upon Jesus Christ can be upon you and I today to achieve the command of God for your life. Amen. Not just the Ten Commandments. I mean, we ought to love the Lord, keep the Ten Commandments. That's a pushover right there. That's a piece of cake. That's common. That's as common as cornbread in Hart County. Amen. We ought to keep the Ten Commandments. I believe that's why God had me working towards that. The devil tries to stop things from happening. Aggravates me. You ever get aggravated? I've been aggravated at the devil. But he wanted us to get the Ten Commandments and all over this country here. Why? Because unless you're willing to keep God's commands, why would he want to pour an anointing on you if you're going to live wrong? Why would he want to put an anointing on you to glorify his name if you ain't even glorifying his name with your life? You ought to live right. You ought to act right. You ought to treat people right. You oughtn't to lie. You oughtn't to cuss. You oughtn't to drink. You oughtn't to do the things that's against the commandment of God. Amen. Amen. I'm talking to you too. That's just a fact. Amen. If we love the Lord, we'll let him bring discipline in our lives about those things. And I tell you, sometimes you just know to do and you can't. You need deliverance. The Holy Ghost will do that for you. I'm telling you, you get filled with the Holy Ghost. You get to crying out to God. You get to wanting it so bad you can't sleep. You want God so bad you can't. And if I want God so bad I can't eat, you know I'm searching. That's for sure. So when you get to that point, you'll find him. I'm telling you, you'll seek for him, and you'll find him when you seek for him with all your heart. Amen. Thank God. So Jesus brought us to that place, and he said, I'll pray the Father, and he'll give you another comforter. That's the Holy Ghost. That's why he said now, don't you leave till you get endued with this power, this Holy Ghost. He gave us a little something right here about what the Holy Ghost is going to do for you. Over in verse 26, it said, but the comforter, who is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he'll teach you a few things. What? Did I miss? Oh, yeah, all things. How about that? Do you think God's a genius? Do you think he's fairly smart? Well, can he teach you all things? Absolutely, he can teach you all things if you'll listen to him and let him be God. Amen? Don't let your smarts outsmart him now. You can't really outsmart him, but if you're not careful, you'll go your own way. Done that, been there, done that, heard testimonies of other people, did it. I'll tell you, if we'll listen to God and spend time with Him, He'll teach us all things. Nothing's too hard for God. Nothing's impossible for God. He can do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond all we could ask or think by the power of the Holy Ghost that's upon us. Ephesians tells us that, right? Amen. So that's the Holy Ghost. That's the Holy Ghost does that. That's the empowering of the Holy Spirit. This Holy Spirit, when He comes, He will teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatever I've said to you. See, I believe when you need to be a Bible student, I believe you need to be a Bible student. Let me talk to you at home here. God expects you to bring your children up and nurture and admonition of the Lord. You too. He expects you to raise your children right. He expects you to teach your children the value of the Bible more than an arithmetic book. Your Bible is more important than language. The Holy Ghost can give you language lessons. Amen. If you'll listen and you'll bring your children up to value the Bible, I mean, that's a precious book because it's God, the Creator, the Sustainer, the one that put you in your mama's womb. It's His words, and He will talk to you, and He will help you if you'll give Him your whole heart and trust Him and trust Him and trust Him when it looks foolish. Trust Him when it looks like it's not the right way to go, but you know Him. Jesus said, "My sheep know My voice," and they won't listen to somebody else. When you get to that point, you're getting mighty close, I can tell you that. And you can get there. We should bring our children up and nurture and admonition of the Lord. I'm telling you, when Sunday comes, they don't ask if we go to church. They know full well to get the toothbrush and let's go. We're going. And we're going. And we're going. And we're going to go back to going more than we're going now. Amen. We're going to get back into this thing. Praise God. The enemy kind of sidetracked us for a while, but we're going to get back into full throttle believing. So he says, the anointing upon you, the Holy Ghost upon you, He'll be your advocate. That's a lawyer. He'll be your counselor. They get paid big money too. He'll be your intercessor. When you don't know how to pray, the Holy Ghost will help you. You come to the end of your rope, you'll just turn your eyes towards heaven and say, "God, I need You. I need You to help me to pray. I don't know how to pray in this area." And then you just lay back, let go, let God. And He'll pray through you. Prayers come from heaven, will come right down to you, through you, and right back up to Him. And it's a prayer that He can answer. I'm telling you. You say, "What use is there to pray like that?" Well, there's a lot of uses. A lot of uses. You'll never figure it out with your pea brain. You got to trust God. That's why you bring your children up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. You teach them to love God and to trust God, because there's going to be some things that's senseless. It seems senseless to pray, babble in another language, unless you know why you're doing that. Babble's not a good word. Speaking in other tongues. What, stammering lips in another tongue, this people. And that's what I'm talking about. You can't just form that yourself. You just lean back on the Holy Ghost, and He brings it through you. Amen. It's a language that's unintelligible to our ear. And unless it's the gifts of the Spirit in operation, it's unintelligible to other people that may be in the room. But it's not to God. You're speaking to God. You're not speaking to other people. Amen. So when you do that, you can rest assured. You'll know within your spirit that you've come to a place and you've arrived. You know, people pray it, call it praying through. Well, that may be what it is, but I know this. I've been a holt of it, and I'm praying and pulling just like I was pulling a big stump across plowed ground. I mean, I'm in the Spirit. I'm agonizing. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost. It really is a difficult time, but I come to that place, whoa, baby, we've come across something here. And you know in your spirit that you've arrived at the right place, and you'll change. You'll go to praising God in the Holy Ghost. You go to praising Him in the Holy Ghost and praising Him in on your own language, because you know that you have come to victory. Victory has been arrived. And I thank God for that being the truth. We ain't got time to give out everything. But the Holy Ghost will be your helper, your counselor, your strengthener. I'm telling you, when you don't have strength, I was weak as still water this morning. I began to pray to the Holy Ghost, begin to speak. I didn't know how to pray. I wasn't hurting. I was just weak. I was just draggy. I began to pray. Oh, praise God. Wasn't long till I could run through a troop, jump over a wall. Amen. I'm praying. It'll help you now. Ain't no doubt about it. How many knows that to be the truth? I'm telling you, when he says he's a helper, he'll help you, praise God. I'm telling you, you'll rise up from there. Something will take place in your life, and you'll rise up. So Jesus went through all that, and what did he go through all that for? He took care of the sin problem so you could approach God without sin or, inferiority. Some people have an inferiority complex. Well, I'm telling you, when you feel like you've sinned, it's hard to approach God. Huh? And maybe you did do something wrong. But aren't you thankful that if we would confess our faults and ask him to forgive us, he will? And then you can approach God. We don't literally walk in the throne room with our feet, but you can, in a sense, in the spirit realm, you can see that you're before God, that you have an audience, that he has eyes only for you. And he's got time to spend with you. Amen? And you just begin to communicate with him. You might have went in there wanting something, but many times once you get in there, you forget about the thing you wanted. You're just glad to be where you're at. Amen? And you just say, well, I don't know what I came for, but I'm sure glad I'm here. And you just, let him talk to you. I tell you, he'll pep you up. He thinks you're his favorite son. He thinks you're his favorite daughter. But I got news for you, I am. No, we're all his favorites. And he'll make you feel like you're the only child he's got. Amen. He loves you that much. Not that he'd leave anybody else. But that's how much he loves each one of us. He's got time for us. He'll listen. And he'll give you words of wisdom if we sit around. And after we talk, we need to listen to him. I mean, listening inside of prayer is 99% of prayer, is to listen to him. And I believe that's why Jesus was so successful. But see, when our sin, when we're loaded with sin, it separates us from God to where we can't hear his voice. But when we get that sin off of us, it brings us nigh unto God. He says, draw nigh unto God, and guess what? God will draw nigh unto you. And what can you do? You can resist the devil, and he'll flee. Amen? Then you can hear God easily. So that's what he wants. He wants you to understand that the washing of the blood of Jesus Christ will purge you from iniquity. Matter of fact, the Bible says that he bore the iniquities of us all in Isaiah. All that stuff was put upon Jesus, and he bore the iniquities of us all, the lawlessness of us all, the sin of us all. He bore it all that we in him and through him and by him could be free from sin, the grip of sin, and free from the consequences of sin. Aren't you thankful today? Amen. How many in here knows you've been under the blood, and the blood of Jesus has washed you from your sin, not in them, but from them? Amen. And now you can approach God. You have the unction. You have the right. God says, come to me. Come unto me. If you're weak, come unto me, all you that are weak and heavy laden. I'll give you rest. And I tell you, when you come in the presence of God and you sit there and listen to him a while, you'll get rest. You'll get peace. So Jesus did all that, and I've got to hush about that. Jesus did all that so you and I could be anointed of the Holy Ghost. And I want you to know, it wasn't just for the apostles. And you that thinks this, that are cessationists, you're wrong. Amen. The Holy Ghost hadn't ceased. He's still doing the same thing today. This is the age of the church. This is the age of the Pentecost moving of God. This is still for us today. There may be an end to it out here somewhere, but not yet. This is the age of grace. God wants to pour his spirit upon you and your sons and daughters. He wants you and your sons and daughters to pray, to speak in tongues, to be filled with the Holy Ghost, to prophesy, to dream dreams, to see visions. Why? Because he wants to bring his kingdom down to earth. When Jesus was here, he went about under the power and unction of the kingdom of God. Ain't that right? He was under the umbrella of power and ability of God of heaven. He brought heaven down. And you see in that, he didn't call nobody. Everybody could get the things of God. Amen. He never had not one single person to get out of line. Amen. He healed them all. He delivered them all. He fed them all. He's good. Amen. And he wants us to do the same thing. Now, last week I used a word that's not normal for me to use. I brought to my attention this morning, I said a word. I'm not going to say what that word is, but I was describing the homosexual agenda, and I used a word that I promise you it never comes out of my mouth. But it did last Sunday, so I apologize about that. I'm not a foul-mouthed preacher. You can ask anybody in here. I'm not. I just let that word slip out. So I apologize about that. I wouldn't want to offend anybody. You may have persuasions and things going on in your life that's not what we normally think is right. But I tell you, God still loves you, and he wants to wash you and cleanse you and dress you up and make a message out of your mess. I'm just telling you he does. And he'll do it if you'll come to him and believe on him and trust him with all your heart, mind, and soul. Amen. God wants you saved. That's why Jesus came and bore that curse and went through all that he went through, is so you could be saved and the Holy Spirit himself could baptize you into the body of Christ. Now today we're going to baptize a young man in water. You won't get to see it because you can't see it with this TV. But we're going to baptize him in water. Why? Because he was immersed into the body of Christ the other day. He was immersed into the body by the Holy Spirit. And now, as an outward sign of what happened on the inside, he comes to be immersed in water in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's exactly what you should do. If you've been born again, you ought to find a water hole somewhere and a preacher somewhere or somebody that's a disciple of Christ and say, I want to be immersed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ as an evident sign of the outside sign of what took place on the inside. Amen? And I believe if you'll do that in faith, you let go of the past, that's a burial. That's what it is. We're coming to a water tank. And Dakota, this is a graveyard. We're going to bury that old man. And we're going to bring up a brand new one. Amen. Amen. We're going to bury the old man in this way. What the old man was doing, what the old man was thinking about, the activities he was involved in, they're going down the drain. But you're going to be raised up to walk a different way. Amen. I don't know. You was probably really good. Amen. Amen. As far as I could tell, you was a good guy before this happened. But now you're a better guy, ain't you? Amen. Why? Because you're a brand new creation in Christ Jesus. You'll understand more about that as you walk on with the Lord, but that's the way it is. We come to knowledge. We come to conviction of our sins. Are you under conviction today? I tell you, Jesus died. The reason he died is to bring you to a conversion moment. And in a conversion moment, it's a conviction moment too. You will be convicted of your sins and your sinful nature. But God don't do that because he don't love you. He does that to show you that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Amen. Now, if you're under that conviction, if you're under that condemnation, the Bible tells us there is therefore no condemnation to them that's in Christ. Not walking by the flesh, but walking in the Spirit, see? So to get out from under that condemnation or that conviction, you just need to die. Good news. You just got to die. That's all you got to do. You die to yourself. You die to that old life. And what we're going to do today, he died the other day, and you know, once a man's died, you ought to keep him out long. You need to put him in the water pretty quick. Put him in the grave. So that's what it is. He died, I don't know, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, whatever it was, early this week. So we're going to put him in the grave. Amen. What are we talking about? Put that old body, baptism. Jesus died, he was buried, and he was raised again. That's what happened to Brandon. He come to recognize he was dead in his sins. And he recognized that Jesus was the answer. So he died to his sins, and now we're going to bury him in Christ, and we're going to raise him up to walk in the newness of life. That's as simple as I can get it right there. Amen. So praise God. The Bible says, whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we're going to baptize him in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father, Son, the Holy Ghost, and that ought to take care of everybody. Amen. Praise the Lord. Are you blessed today? Amen. Let's close our eyes just a minute here. Let me ask you a question. It's a simple question, but it's pretty strong too. What would happen to you if you died instantly? What would happen to you right now if your heart just stopped? Well, I tell you one thing that's going to happen to you. You're going to die. And then what? You're going somewhere. There's not but two places you go to. You go to a devil's hell or you go to God's heaven. Two places. You don't go somewhere and they pray you out of there. No. Sorry about that. That ain't true. There's no place in the Bible that tells you that. Amen. For a Christian to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. For a lost person to be absent from the body is to be in hell. And it's going to get worse. Because the day of judgment, hell's going to bring up its dead and they're all going to be cast in the lake of fire. Ain't going to get better for you. I don't know. If you've ever been burnt a little bit, think about a lake afar. That don't sound like a good place, does it? You don't want to go there, I'll just be honest with you. So what's the answer? I'll tell you the answer. Turn to Christ. Turn to Jesus. Ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins. Repent of your sins. Ask God to wash you from your sins, that you can be filled with His Spirit and live for Jesus. In this house today, is anybody in this house today that with uplifted hands say, "Preacher, pray for me. I'm under conviction. I'm lost, and I know it today." You might have thought you were saved 2 years ago, 5 years ago, but today you know you're under conviction and you need to do something. And it could be many Christians get under conviction because they walked away from God. They've turned away. They haven't sought Him like they should. They haven't followed Him, and they realize that they're not where they need to be with the Lord. If that's you today, won't you just repent of your sins? Won't you ask God to forgive you of your sins? If you're here today and you've never been born again, you've never called Jesus your Savior and Lord, we would like for you to come to this altar and just show God and show the world, I mean business. I'm serious about it. I want to walk out of this world, and I want to live with Jesus Christ, even today. If you're here today and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, would you come without hesitation or reservation? You at home, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, would you get on your face before God, ask God to forgive you? I believe He's faithful. If you ask Him to forgive you, I believe He will. If you're serious about it, I know He will. Amen? So let's pray a prayer together. Father, we ask You to search our hearts, O God, if there's a wicked way in us anywhere. Reveal that to us, Father, that we might repent of that and get that out of our lives. Father, if there's somebody in the sound of our voice that don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, I pray, Father, Your convicting power would be upon them and convict them and convince them to the point that they need to repent, and that with a repentant heart they would turn Your direction, seeking You, asking You to accept them and to change them into a child of God. I know You're willing to do it. I know You want all men saved. You don't want any to perish. So I praise You and thank You for being that away. You're a good God, and I thank You that all call upon Your name shall be saved. You said so in Your word. So I thank You for doing that. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to let the congregation by live feed go. And we got some business to see to here. If you want to come ahead and get ready for baptism, Dakota. And has anybody else come to be baptized too? I put it on the Facebook that.